Madam Vice President, High Commissioner, esteemed colleagues and distinguished guests, I'm honored to build upon the insightful perspectives shared by my fellow panelists as we address the critical issue of ensuring livelihood resilience in a context of loss and damage from climate change. The presentations we've heard thus far have underscored the urgency of this challenge and the equitable approaches needed to address it. As we have already heard, the impacts of climate change on human rights are profound and far-reaching. Building on these observations, I'd like to focus our attention on the legal dimensions of this crisis, particularly the evolving landscape of climate litigation and its potential to address loss and damage and enhance livelihood resilience. The recent advisory opinion from the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea marks a significant milestone in this evolving legal landscape. By affirming that anthropogenic emissions of greenhouse gases constitute marine pollution, ITLOS reminds us that oceans are not merely carbon sinks, but vital ecosystems to be protected and preserved. Crucially, ITLOS recognized that complying with the Paris Agreement alone is not sufficient for compliance with international law relating to climate change. A recognition also flowing from recent pronouncements by domestic courts and regional human rights bodies. This ITLOS opinion is particularly timely given the pending advisory proceedings before the International Court of Justice, as referenced in the Council's own resolution 53/6. The ICJ has been asked to determine the legal consequences of state conduct that has, over time, caused significant harm to the climate system and other parts of the environment. This provides an unprecedented opportunity to clarify state obligations regarding loss and damage in the context of human rights. Notably, youth from around the world who have been calling for this advisory opinion are now urging all states to recognize the duty to make reparations as a legal consequence of the conduct that has caused climate change. Clarifying these existing obligations aims to ensure that finance for livelihood resilience is provided at scale, not as a matter of charity, but as a matter of obligation, aimed at restoring the rights of those most affected. Similarly, the Inter-American Court of Human Rights is currently considering an advisory opinion request on the climate emergency and human rights. As articulated in submissions to the Inter-American Court made by the same youth groups and several states, loss and damage from climate change engages the responsibility of states under human rights law, carrying legal consequences. Indeed, the acts and omissions causing and exacerbating loss and damage can be attributed to specific actors, extending back to the onset of industrialization. By the 1960s, the causal link between anthropogenic emissions and climate change was firmly established. As ITLOS made clear, this scientific consensus has led to a higher, more stringent standard of due diligence, and states that have failed to meet the requisite standard incur international responsibility. By clarifying these legal frameworks, judicial processes can help give effect to states' human rights obligations, such as the obligation to mobilize resources for livelihood resilience in the face of loss and damage. Obligations that must be operationalized through innovative financing measures like carbon and wealth taxes, levies on sectors like fossil fuels, aviation and shipping, and increased business accountability for climate harms. International law requires all responses to be equitable, with the principle of common but differentiated responsibilities and the polluter pays principle guiding UNFCCC processes, including on the Santiago Network, the Loss and Damage Fund, and the Collective Quantified Goal on Climate Finance. civil society organizations have been calling for climate reparations both within and beyond the UNFCCC context. These calls emphasize the need for comprehensive rights-based redress, including compensation for losses, rehabilitation of affected ecosystems and communities, and guarantees of non-repetition through rapid and equitable emissions reductions, criminalization of ecocide, and bans on speculative and dangerous responses such as geoengineering. Such measures are crucial for protecting livelihoods and ensuring resilience. Equally imperative and required on the human rights law are measures to eliminate systemic discrimination and barriers that limit the adaptive capacity of disproportionately impacted groups. Respect for indigenous peoples' sovereign rights and full reparations for historical injustices must be a central part of approaches to avert, minimize, and address loss and damage and protect livelihoods. To conclude, we have the legal framework, the scientific understanding, and the moral imperative to ensure livelihood resilience for all in the face of loss and damage. What we need now is the political will to deliver rights-based responses through constructive engagement with pending advisory proceedings and other legal initiatives, a focus on rights and justice in the UNFCCC negotiations, and affirmative measures at the domestic level. Let us collectively rise to this challenge with the dedication and compassion that it demands. Thank you.